Then you'll see next the Achievement Center. And that's taking the new number for the Achievement Center, which is reduced from my original proposal by, as a result of the assumption of a $50,000 grant from the CEF and some changes in staffing and other lines that I'll talk about in more detail later. So, but that $90,530 corresponds to the $90,530 with the dollar change for the Achievement Center that you see in the overall budget that I was given to you. The NEAS expenses are an unusual one-year expense. Good news is that this coming budget year is the last time we'll see NEAS for another 8 or 9 years. We'll be able to take that out of the budget. But, and I didn't put down the code number. If you're wondering where you find that, that corresponds to code 8920-1620 under the Office of the Principal. You'll find $10,500. And I'll talk about that in more detail a little bit later as well, and I'm sure you'll have some questions about it. But that is essentially the cost of the school district of hosting, housing, providing facilities for 15 team members that are reporting to us on October 16th for 4 days to take a look at the high school. And then you'll see deferred renovation expenses. These are expenses that as the budget was formulated through the building committee in connection with high school renovation, certain things were backed out in order to get to the amount of money that was approved by the voters. And I'll talk about those in more detail as well. I wanted to start off sort of with the big picture, and then I'll go over those, and I'll answer any questions you have about specific items. But one of the things I do want to point out under that deferred renovation expense is CIP budget items. The number there, CIP budget items, is $19,061 deferred renovation expenses. And I'd like the board to understand that every single dollar that the high school has asked for this year is deferred renovation expenses. We have essentially zeroed out the traditional requests that we make in connection with CIP budget for replacement furniture, for teacher desks, the kinds of things that are we have none of that for next year in the budget because we have some significant deferred renovation things. And then non-salary special education expenses, and I know Claire is going to speak to this. The bulk of that, in fact, about 99% of it, I think, relates to one likely out-of-district day treatment placement. But I'll leave that for now. Claire talk about it. Another one of those things out of our control. So the total of all those designated sources is $282,568. Sources of increase for the high school. And then you compare that to the $245,805, which is our total request of increase. I guess the point that I'm trying to make clearly is that the rest of the budget is a decrease from where we have been in the past. By $37,000.
I just want to be clear on the CIP budget items and deferred renovation expenses.
Yes.
The bulk of them were items that the building committee took out of the referendum monies that the school department at that time was willing to take on at a cost savings to the taxpayers.
Correct.
Because they were items that Ernie could do for less money than having the contractors do. So while we took on the responsibility of adding them to our line item in our yearly budget, it basically is saving the taxpayers money. It's
right.
Just unfortunate that we're going to be bearing it rather than spread out over a 20-year bond issue. So it was very gracious of us to do.
No, I'm not saying they weren't good decisions.
Yeah, I wish we didn't have to go there, but we knew that
right.
In an effort to get the best value for the building project and to move forward and prioritize the other important things that we could never do or Ernie couldn't do on his own to make sure that they happened. So that's a little bit of background on that.
follow that. If you want to take a look at that, then certainly feel free to stop me at any point. Specific questions? Okay. On the first page, you'll see really, in a different way, just sort of made the same point that we're coming into a year, which is a different year because of three factors we're at the high school. One is the accreditation visit. One is the hope for creation of an achievement center. And then the renovation project, and we need to absorb some of those expenses to sort of complete the renovation. Then on page two, we do have under the equipment 8900, that's 1730 line. We have a $14,475 increase in that particular line. I'm guessing that would be one that people are going to know a little bit about, a little bit more detail, because it's one of the few that has any significant increase. Most of this is also renovation related expenses. The renovation includes in the science classrooms installing fixtures that will exist hanging down from the ceiling for science teachers to be able to display through a multimedia projector and data projector things that are going on the laptops and teachers' computer screens as teachers are doing labs and that sort of thing. But the renovation project did not, well, backed out of the renovation project, did not include the projectors themselves. So there's a significant cost for that, which is $7,200. Some of you may know if you enjoy going on for a Gym 4. You might have noticed that in the two places on the Gym 4 court, on the Gym 4, there are things that have been inserted into this, have been dug into the floor that are essentially screw holes for new stanchions for volleyball standards. And right now what happens is we have some very old volleyball standards which have wheels on them and we wheel them across the gym floor, and it's not something we'd like to continue to have happen because we've got a really nice gym floor. And we specifically designed the gym floor to include those that ability to have for that to buy one set. We've got two sets of stanchion holders, but I'm thinking it will try to get Scott Shea tells me we'll probably get away with having one for next year and then maybe have another one following. I've also put a couple thousand dollars in for a new floor surface for the weight room that's being constructed within the renovated locker room facilities. Essentially to absorb the bang of free weights hitting the floor, otherwise the floor surface would pretty quickly crack. And then I've got various, within the CIP budget itself, as I said, there's almost a little over $19,000 worth of expenses related to completion of the gym, the main office, the guidance office. And essentially what happened during the course of the building project is all of the money that they recently put into furniture was taken out. So there are a couple of areas, and it's essentially the main entrance things where citizens and community parents come in and they first encounter staff in the high school. We are trying to get something that's really nice in those particular areas for the secretarial purposes. And the guidance, the main office and the guidance office specifically designed for certain areas of student work centers and that sort of thing. They're going to be out in the public. And so we wanted to get something that's reasonably decent as opposed to what we have now, which we have behind. It looks terrible. And that's essentially it for that account, 8900-1730. That's the equipment for that. 8915-3620 is another one that has a somewhat larger increase. It's an increase of $3,640. Those of you who've been board members for some time will no doubt recall the annual request from the librarian to replace the tables in the library. And every, I think, well, every year that I've been here, we put the money in and we take it out. And what we're proposing to do this year is to hire essentially the maintenance department each year for the next 3 years to build one-third of the number of tables, so that at the end of the 3 years, we'll have a better furniture in the library, which is also a very heavily used facility by the public. Then under office of your principal accounts, the only significant increase is, well, actually it's the only increase in it at all is for the accreditation related expenses. And I've detailed those in the chart on page 3. If you have any questions about the specifics, then it is inherent within DS that we are required to feed and house 15 people for 4 days. And so we've done it as inexpensively and efficiently as we can, given the resources that we have in the area. We're actually, in our total DS budget, we're proposing to pay less than most schools do on average to accommodate folks. They work very hard for us. The information will be very valuable to us. The unfortunate thing is we're able, because the NYDC has been very generous with us, to put them up in a very nice place, which they will not be able to enjoy at all, because when you're on one of those accreditation teams, there is no time to enjoy anything. You're working from 6 o'clock in the morning until literally 10 o'clock and sometimes 11 o'clock at night. So it's a great professional development opportunity for people who are part of it, and it's a great benefit to the school, but it's not a lot of fun. And I've done a presentation before, most recently about the Achievement Center. Working with Bob and Pauline, we brought down the total increase for the Achievement Center in a number of line items. And this memo that you have, I think, doesn't reflect some of those changes. So I wanted to go over it briefly and just tell you, consistent with the budget document that you have in front of you, which was changed after I prepared this memo, so that two things are corresponding to one another. And specifically on the staffing, let me go to page 7, where it talks about the budget proposal for an Achievement Center. The salary budget, 8901, 1110, has actually been brought down from 105 to 93. And that's essentially through the elimination of a request to have a part-time English teacher in there to help with some of the writing conferences. I'm still hopeful that we'll be able to do that through some creative scheduling in the high school once we get our course tallies and things like that. So it's not necessarily eliminating the function, which I think is important to have, but I think we have a really good potential to be able to find somebody and get swing somebody in our totally different ways. I do want to point out quickly that the number for the salary budget has really decreased more than 105,000. 3,000, because as your question was Patricia, and the dialogue with Gary has indicated that from with Bob, I think, the teacher reduction in technology is actually related to this as well. So that it's really $17,000 to $18,000 below this as well. It's just that it doesn't show up, that change doesn't show up specifically under the Achievement Center code. 8901, 1150, proceeding on that request has been eliminated. So that $5,000 is gone. You won't see it in the budget document in front of you. The other provisions on page 7 are continue to be in the budget. The other one that has been eliminated is 8901-1730. That equipment request for $10,000 has been taken out. Not that we're not going to have computer equipment in there, but working with Bob and Paul, I think we have some other ways to get that in there than buying new equipment. So we are trying to do that. We've been pairing that. I think one of the board members asked me the last time we met about the continuing expense for the Plato software after the first year. I talked year, the cost per plate went over from $35,000 with the initial purchase to an ongoing approximately $3,000 to $4,000 expense for subsequent years.
Elaine, just a note, I gave the wrong figure then when I gave Karen some information yesterday. I projected at around $8,000 a year, so it's actually less than that. But that is a substantial decrease when we start talking about future years of the funding and so forth. Our funding.
The other thing that I wanted to just sort of point out as I wrap up and then open up to whatever questions we have is the things that we asked for and didn't get, I know that's been a subject of some interest. I asked for an increase in science staff, and that was basic, that would have met a need which I think down the road is going to become imperative to increase the time that our kids experience with science. Our students have no added time. They have the same schedule, they have the same amount of time as our students do in science and English and math and every other area. That is different from most other schools. And I think it's a problem. But it's been a problem for some time. It's been a problem for a long time. So next year we'll be addressing. Latin. For folks who were on the board last year will recall the conversations we had about Latin and the consensus among with me and the folks who are from the parents who had their kids go through the Latin program and that sort of stuff. There's no question that the best scenario for Latin is to continue in high school is to be able to offer two sections of Latin, one, and then one section of Latin, two, because the pattern ever since we put it on the back of the course of studies is that's just the pattern we get. We get enough to fill two classes in Latin one, and then some of the kids don't and decide they've got the benefit of it that they want to get, and they drop out from but I was hoping to be able to get to that sustainable level, but this budget doesn't include that. I don't know.
Can you clarify, Jeff? So you have two sections of Latin 1, one section of Latin 2, or you'd like a second section of Latin 2?
No, right now we have two sections. This is the year, I think. We really should be able, if Latin is going to be sustained on an ongoing basis, eventually we have to get to the point where we have a 3/5 Latin teacher. And each year, that Latin teacher would be teaching two sections of Latin 1 and one section of Latin 2. Right now, we just have a 2/5 Latin teacher. And I believe this, we change it each year depending on what the course assignments are. But I believe this year, he's just offering Latin 1. That's the year we're on right now. So that means something.
I believe that's accurate because he was offering to keep kids who took it last year up with this year, up with their Latin in case they were going to be ready to take Latin 2 next year.
So right now, we don't have the option for students to take Latin 2.
This year, we do not. It's in the program of studies again for next year. So what Bob is referring to is we have a cadre of students who took Latin 1 last year, who wanted to take Latin 2 this year. We couldn't do it. So they are waiting to, at least some of them will show up again on their doorstep to take Latin 2 next year, which we will have to offer, but because we can't have, if that really transpires, if we have a sign up, the priority is going to be offer at least one section of Latin 2, because otherwise they're going to be 2 years before. But what that means is we're not going to be offering a number of kids who want to take Latin 1 next year will not be able to do it. And the teacher has been trying this year to sort of periodically feed kids some tests and some other things without any instruction going on with it to try to sort of somewhat keep up their skills and not too, but I suspect that the engagement in that is was sort of good intention, I guess, is not allowed to do that.
Jeff, how many kids do you have to want to take Latin 2
in the It was between 15 and 20. I'm not sure exactly. The other thing that is not included in the budget is classroom furniture. Included in the CIP budget. That used to be the core of what we included in CIP was not included in this year. There is not a budget dollar for flagpole or a flagpole replacement. However, I believe the senior class, this point, it looks like the senior class is going to be class gift of applying to the school. So that will be good, because it was not a pretty picture about a nice new road entrance in the school with the old rusty flagpole. There is no money in the budget for cafeteria, new cafeteria tables, even though we are expanding the cafeteria. So what we are doing is we're going to bring out the mothballs, some old cafeteria tables. The one that concerns me the most, actually, is shelving. There's a lot of money in the budget for shelving. That a lot of times taken out. We're counting on Ernie's crew to give us a lot of shelving this summer. Shelving in the new science storage areas, shelving in the PE storage area, the athletic storage area, just office storage area, just about every storage area you can name.
Well, wasn't it, if I remember correctly from the building committee, the shelving that was in the building committee budget was very expensive, and Ernie had indicated that he was able to significantly reduced cost. I think it just was a matter of when we could get to it, when this folks could get to it. So it sounds like we are going to get the shelving, maybe not as quickly as we wanted to, but definitely cheaper. Is that what you remember?
Yes. I mean, but the school's paying for it.
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, people question why our CIP budget is high for high school and want to do the basically to understand that the intent was to save the taxpayers' money, not to spend it.
Right, and I mean, there was a lot of cuts that were made in the building committee to get to the number that we had to get to. And I wanted to point that out. I mean, like you were saying, that we did, there was a lot of things on the ad alternate that never made it back. And this was one of the things that was on the alternate. We are getting some of it back. That's a good thing.
What I get a little bit concerned about, and I was part of the building committee and I supported that, I think it made all the sense in the world. As I go through the plans, as we get closer to actually completing some things, I begin to know more and more sort of the dreaded NIC, not including the contract designation, which appears in more places than I was aware of. I have total faith that Ernie's crew will get it done, but it's going to be a longer process, I think.
And some of that I found interesting to note is that when you have a new building running, and a new building is being made, there's a line item that is for shelving and furniture, and it's an accepted percentage of the cost of this.
Movable equipment.
Yeah, that's in the budget. When you do a renovation, those items aren't in there, so you have to plan for them, and that's where the building committee tended to back off, you know. And, you know, I'm curious about, for example, the cafeteria tables. I mean, what are we talking about? Are we talking about old round tables like we had before? Are these something that are coming from, you know, the old middle school that...
No, as I understand it, and I haven't seen them, or, you know, I just wasn't taking a tour. Tells me they're in decent shape.
Yeah, well.
They're tables that are identical to what we have right now.
I mean, I remember at one point, you know, we were very excited about the option of offering high school students some alternative seating, you know, that you see in Yarmouth, and I've seen in, you know, the various schools that are, make a lot of sense. But thank you, Ernie, for finding those and doing that. And
I'll take it when I see
her. I'm going to get library tables. I'm going to call Jen to set up. Should be that Ernie's going to make them.
And frankly, when we get down to near the end of the project, there are going to have to be some decisions made as to what's still in there, because we did put some money in for clerk and works, which we haven't used to date.
That's right.
We do have some contingency monies. And does it go for some of those things that we didn't include up till now, or does it go for more of these types of things? So those decisions are going to have to be made as we come down closer to the end of the project.
school board and the building committee can convene to help make those decisions before that money disappears.
Jeffrey, on 8901, fringe benefits, then on 8901, 1210, fringe benefits, no fringe benefits. Is that?
They're included in the salary amounts. When you look at the salary, the fringe benefits are included because.
It's in salary.
It's only an estimate because we have not hired, there's no one in that position currently. So we don't know what they'll take for benefits. We just put in an estimate.
The estimates are $50,000 for one and $48,800 for the other, inclusive of benefits.
First, I'd like to humorously suggest that instead of a buy a brick, like we've done at Fort Williams, that maybe we need to buy a table fundraiser for the high school. Two questions. Science is the focus, science education, everything, all the way down from our Harvard president's comments. Is there any alternative funding for science out there, grant monies? I mean, I know that's not the ideal, but that's sort of an aside, just a question, and you don't even need to answer that. I'm just curious to know if that's something that we could pursue. Second question, the Achievement Center. This is going to be an ongoing cost. Once you put it in there, it's there. Do we see, and the answer is probably no, but just want to check, first, any offsetting savings in any of the out years? And two, if they're not savings per se, and I know we've talked about this a little bit, do you foresee that potentially it could become break even? Like I'm thinking, I know eventually the staffing there is focused on high school students, but your summer school program, can it, that space perhaps at least be used with maybe different resources? Can you see it becoming a break-even center?
I'd be wildly optimistic that it would be a break-even center, but I do see some revenue opportunities for it. I know I was talking to Eileen Sheehy, who's the assistant principal at Wells, and they just opened this year a Plato lab in Wells High School. And Plato is being used in their adult education program. Revenues for that, and some of those go to the school budget. The other one is summer school, to the extent that in the summer school, and there is a payment that goes to summer school, there are many more opportunities for Plato there. I know up in Lewiston High School, which has the biggest Plato installation in the state, may generate a fair amount of revenue. I'm sure it's not break even in Lewiston either, but there are some possibilities. So in special education, the Achievement Center will be a key ingredient in meeting the new demands for response to intervention, which is part of what the new federal law mandates. In other words, it's another tool. It's not a special ed tool, but before you identify a student in special ed, we would endeavor to put them through the Achievement Center to see if we can make some headway there, so that avoid necessity. That's not a reduction that you've ever seen in the budget, but it would be sort of an avoided increase in the budget.
Jeff, under the Achievement Center, I'm disappointed to hear that we're having to cut the part-time English teacher. So are you talking about that would be number four under the staffing of the Achievement Center? I mean, you list the full-time. Number one being the full-time achievement manager, number two is the full-time teacher with strong writing skills. So is this?
That's number four.
Yeah, that's number four.
But that is the position that I believe that I can make that happen.
Because it just, and admittedly, I did miss your presentation on the Achievement Center, so I'm not as up to speed on that as probably everybody else is. But just in looking through this, it seems like it's really really strong in terms of staff on technology, but much less strong in terms of teaching expertise. And that really helps to.
Well, I guess, I mean, I look at both the manager and the other person as, I'm looking for people who have technology expertise and teaching expertise.
Yeah, I mean, I see that.
But in ter- you're right, in terms of teachers from core discipline areas in the Achievement Center, it's not, you're not going to be able to pick that out quite as easily. And that's another thing that is like, as we go through scheduling this year and look at course tallies and that sort of stuff, I'm going to be looking at each of the core areas and seeing if there's ways that I can bring teachers in, depending on how the course tallies work out. And I think I would be able to do that to some extent. My top priority would be that English position. Because to me, that's a critical, it's a small piece from a budgetary standpoint, but it's important to me because that's the one piece that brings, that would bring regular, bring non-struggling students in on a regular basis so that every kid in high school would see what's going on in the Achievement Center and would be in the Achievement Center probably several times a year. And I think that's really critical in terms of opening it up and changing it, starting off with the right perception of it.
Right, and so you're just hoping to pull teachers at different times in there to compensate for losing that position.
Well, what I'm looking for is if I can play with the numbers a bit and this, the number of sections, if I can reduce, have a teacher in high school who's in the high school now teach four sections as part of that, plus have an assigned period as part of their additional duties to be in the room, to be in the Achievement Center. And I'm pretty confident that I have people who'd be willing to do that if it doesn't, if their numbers otherwise work out.
And so is that sort of the same way that you would handle the halftime organizational coach position?
That position would still be, I'm sorry, did I say that was done? No, that's still going to be there.
That is not a cost item.
Right, but I mean, okay.
To transfer a person from another.
Right, there's somebody who's already there.
That's right.
Right, who's going to be doing that. So that's sort of the same way that you would be able to
that's
work correct. That.
That's right. So, I mean, through talking with Pauline about it, we tried to sit down and be creative about, are there some resources that we can use? I mean, the biggest sort of trade-off that I decided to make, and I'm hoping that when we go through the scheduling that we can adjust this one a little bit as well, is at least running a budget scenario at this point before we actually get the sign-ups, as I've said, that we can, if we need to, we can take away a six-tenths technology teacher position and substitute that for time ed tech. And that's a real sacrifice because it means there are certain elective courses that we currently offer and would like to continue to offer, we're saying are not as high a priority as offering the Achievement Center.
Okay.
This question is not necessarily directly from you, Jeff, as most of my questions have not been from anybody. But are we talking about buying this Plato software outright?
Yes.
Why? I know I'm not asking for a question, being rhetorical. Do we have a technology lease coming up that can be folded into? Is $35,000 enough to finance over 3 years? Because if we took the $35,000 over 3 years, I mean, take the $35,000 over 3 years, 36 months, okay? You just found your money for your English person. Okay, that's one.
You mean essentially finance the purchase of it?
Yeah.
Pay Plato outright, but then finance it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like we would do with a bus. Or a laptop computers.
Right.
There's one, and I'm just throwing that out to all of you. Mm-hmm. The next thing is, if we calculated the non-recurring startup costs in total. We're talking about Plato costs $35,000. Outlay, whether it's over 1 year or 3 years. Presuming the 1 year outlay, okay, in the second year we go into annual maintenance and service, which is $3,000. So the cost of the Achievement Center in total goes down $32,000,
right,
at the end of the first year. How, whether that's allocated to picking up a greater portion of the seat or a teacher or something else is an opportunity to examine. So that's why I'm saying we could even further capitalize on that. If if we went back and looked at Plato and said, okay, let's do a third of it, that would leave us 20 grand, roughly, in the budget, in the, of the total budget limit that we're talking about right now, that might put that English person back in, or pump that English position back up. Just a thought.
It's worth exploring. The other side of that, that the safe money is upfront money to get it started. It's not going to continue. If it's as tight a budget next year as it is this year, that would be a $32,000 savings next year that potentially that could help to do some other things that you need to do. So those were sort of the trade-offs in thinking about how we approach it. It's, we can certainly look into both approaches and
that's all I'm asking you to do. Sure. It seems like the easiest way to approach the academic piece of this, the academic core that's going to reach out to all students, without increasing the budget, except for whatever the interest expense is.
You can do that, we will.
There's a question after that. Is it prudent or have we looked at combining those types of needs with another school system? Like we have, say, 15 kids that might take Latin 2, and you know, maybe South Portland has 15, and maybe Scarborough has 15 or whatever. Have we looked at that, or is that something that we should do in terms of maybe we could have a Latin 2 class that somehow, I don't know where it's located, but it somehow meets the needs of the several communities and then gets paid for over by several communities?
This is the one year that I haven't explored that. I've actually explored that every single year since Latin was added to the curriculum, with South Portland primarily, because they do have a Latin program at South Portland. What has made it impossible thus far, and I presume that it would make it impossible this year as well, is the schedule. No two high schools in the state virtually have the same schedule. And usually there is some rotation that's involved in the schedules, so that kids are in different places at different times and the classes don't happen at the same time. So we had talked about that in Portland. We got somewhat serious about it a couple years ago. We really tried to sit down and see if we could make it work. And we just couldn't make it work as creative as we were at that time. Maybe there are some other things. I'd be glad to call in again and see if we think that there's anything that might work.
Let me just ask a follow-up question. Is that important to people? Could it be scheduled after normal school hours if they wanted to take it? And say the school gets out at, you know, at 2 o'clock is the magic time. If they really wanted to take it, and it was that important to the students and or their parents, could it be scheduled at 2 o'clock in a building that is virtually empty at this point?
It's been done with other things, Kathy. There were the city of Portland, or Portland school system, used to offer a Russian program, and students would have an evening program. But students had to commit to it and go, but it was another way of doing it. And certainly look at that to see if there is anything like that around. I don't know that there's anything in existence.
I don't think there's a Latin.
Yeah.
I wasn't here at the time.
Most schools, if they have 1 year of Latin, have 2 years of Latin.
We used to participate in the Russian program, and I think they also have another language, but the numbers, once you see
the Russian thing, you know?
How long did it take?
Yeah.
I think it must have been 7 to 10 years. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Because I was thinking exactly what you were saying, I was just kept that. I know kids that I've worked with once upon a time, and we're taking, going up to Portland to take Russian. And that's a method that can be looked at in terms of scaling other cooperative ventures, I think.
And I'm just thinking, if it's important enough to people and we could explore that there is a possibility of offering something, but it's going to be at this time, at this location, you know, and we need to know in advance.
would that serve you, they have, and with your kids? Be willing to do it as well. So, but at least that gives an option to this.
Right, it's not an absolute no, but it's a, here's an opportunity.
I'd just like to add a little weight to that, because I'm a strong supporter of the Latin of language. I wish somehow you could do it any.
I'm sorry, as I was responding to that, and Bob and Paulina are all having the same reaction, which is that in Crawford after school, there's still a cost.
Right.
Unless it's a tuition.
It's the money.
Yeah.
That's actually a shared cost.
Right.
But then looking at that, that's Latin 2 with the South Portland. I have to see what South Portland is the one we're talking about.
No, we're constantly being asked to look into the.
Right, well, that's what I was thinking.
Perhaps that would be a basis for.
But then you're asking.
But I think it's certainly worth looking, yeah, that's exactly what I'm asking.
No, but then you're asking South Portland to offer last period and maybe out of school before our high school gets out of school. So it's going to be done after the school hours. You have to invite them to benefit, don't you?
Exactly.
Make money.
This is equivalent to the unions.
I've got a question about Plato and the software. Is that the only software that's out there? After the presentation of the Achievement Center, I had a telephone call from a gentleman who said, why are we spending all that money for Plato? Isn't this something less expensive? So I'll ask you the question if he has it. Last year, I researched as thoroughly as I could what programs there were out there. And as I looked at it, Hillary, there were really two programs that do what I would want to have them do. In other words, that they have the potential to be K-12, and they're not just focused on one curriculum. There are lots of programs out there that do, for example, reading or writing or math in different areas. But what I was looking for is something that we could get that, instead of buying six different computer things, that we could get one that's more all-encompassing and gives us more flexibility and has some K-12 possibilities of the down the line can expand. There are two that are out there, and they are Plato and NovaNet is the other one. And NovaNet is now owned by Pearson Publishing. I'm not sure the complete name of it. I don't remember all the details off the top of my head, but my recollection is that NovaNet is less expensive initial purchase, not significantly, but less expensive initial purchase, but significantly more when you look at the annual upgrade fees. And NovaNet also had, and again, I apologize, I don't remember the specifics, but NovaNet had more, it didn't have as many offerings. It wasn't as flexible in terms of K-12 and what it offered, and I can't remember which it was, but it either was initially developed as a high school product and then they tried to add components to the younger grades, or it was the reverse. They did it, it started as the earlier grades and then they tried to add high school components, and it wasn't as strong across the board as I think it was. But that's the only one that I'm aware of that I would say is at all competitive with Plato. And it is used in a lot of places, as is Plato.
I'm reading your call to have an alternative suggestion, or was it just a question?
Was it just a question whether or not something was
interesting?
Very short.
It's going to be very quick. Every year when I come to you and present a special ed budget, I stress how fortunate we are that we have been, that we have a budget for our district placement. And I think this is one year that we had to add it in the budget. And I think one of the reasons we don't have a lot of out-of-district placements, and it's a compliment to this community, their willingness to have OT, PT, psychologists, social workers on staff. And I think it's because of that that we have been able to educate our students right in their home schools. However, this year we have had, or we have an instance that we really feel that the students' needs are way out beyond what we're able to do at this time, given the situation the student is in. So we've had to include that in the budget. Our my hope is that it won't be a long-term placement and that we will be able to reintegrate the student back in his or her home. So that's really the major increase at the high school.
Do you know that this is an absolute in terms of this placement, or did I hear you say that it's probably going to happen?
We are investigating. The order has been made by the pupil evaluation team for the student be sent to a day treatment. However, there's an application process and that is happening right now. Hopefully we'll find a school that will be willing to accept the student.
And so the dollar figure in there is, it is, what you know to be?
It's the school that we are presently looking at.
Okay. So assuming all the paperwork is done, is this place that will get A for this year?
For this year, maybe, yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions? Are we ready for motion?
Incredible. I mean, they sort of jump-started all, so I think the job fair is a good thing for that position. Also, in that budget, there's a proposed 3% increase for the administrative staff, and that is upon the recommendation of the superintendent. So we have built in a 3% increase for those office staff people. The adult ed budget is a fairly flat budget. We reclassified some of our instructors from being paid through payroll to be paid as independent contractors. A few years ago, the IRS sort of clamped down on how people were paid in adult ed and recreation programs, and we ended up putting everyone on payroll. Well, now we're recognizing that some of those people do this for their livelihood. They're under company names and so forth, so we moved some people from a payroll status into an independent contractor status. So that's why you see some differences in those lines. Our instructors are paid hourly, sometimes by percentage of revenue, and sometimes paid by individual number of patrons in a class. So they may be paid on a per patron basis. And that's always negotiable. Depends on what kind of service we are soliciting and what kind of agreement I can make with those folks who come to provide us with programs. Our summer program serves over 1,000 different children in the summertime, preschoolers through high school students. Last year, enrolled in our day camp program, which was first through fifth grade, we had 495 different kids. Our middle school camp numbers were down last year, and I attribute that to a couple of things. The capability camps are getting more attractive to these kids, and they're doing multiple capability camps. And middle schoolers, by nature, tend to wait to the last minute to sign up for things. They need to make sure it's what their peers are doing. And so when we started to hire staff for the summer, our numbers were way down. Can't have five staff for 25 kids. And so we actually reduced our staff to 3 people. And then, of course, after the first week of camp, the numbers started to come in, and we were able to pick up a 4th staff person for the bigger numbers. But I think it's a case of lots out there for that age population, and also they're just waiting to see what happens before they sign up. So those numbers were at about 70 different 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. Our preschool camp, which provides programs for kids that are 1 year away from kindergarten and those that are entering kindergarten, had 3 sections, and we had 92 different preschoolers participate in that program. Our capability camps, of which we had about 25 last year, all but one camp ran with sufficient enrollment. 7 of the camps had waiting lists, and we actually had 438 different kids enrolled in our capability camps. And those camps encompass grades 6 through 12, but certainly the bulk of the kids are 6 through 9 that participate in that camp. And then we did soccer camps, and in the soccer camps, we had over 202 registrations in three different soccer camps that we contracted services with. Our youth programs are our after-school enrichment program, which is things that happen right after the school day. Most of them end in time for students to hop on the late bus and ride home. We've seen significant growth in this program. Last semester, we registered 500 different kids in 2 hours of registration. When I got my budget printout the other day, our projected revenues for that program for this year was $30,000, and year-to-date we've taken in $59,000. Now, that's not $30,000 in profit, but you know, more programs, more participation, also more expenses. But we've seen significant growth there. In our Saturday soccer programs, I think we do an excellent job for the preschool population through grade 3. Once students get to grade 4, they tend to go to the travel soccer, Casco Bay approach to soccer. But in the kindergarten program, as an example, I think Tom said there are 110 kindergartners, and we had 98 enrolled in our Saturday kindergarten soccer program. And we seem to have that high percentage in grades 1, 2, a little less than 3, and as you go up, the participation per grade level goes down. Our extended school care program, which services over 140 children, I was told yesterday, currently enrolled, we have 151. And we have offered people on the waiting list a place in the program. So we actually have exhausted the waiting list. Everyone who is on it has had the opportunity to join. So at this point, we're not in a waiting list situation. Certainly, the new facility has made this a very attractive program for kids and parents. It's sort of their neighborhood away from home, and you know, the numbers and the demand for services just continues to grow. In the kindergarten section, we actually have 51 kindergartners out of the 110 enrolled, so we are serving a huge amount of that population as well. And as you can see, that program generates a lot of revenue. Our revenues are over $200,000, with our expenditures just being over $100,000. And someone says, "Wow, that, you know, you're making a huge profit on that program." But what you need to consider is that program uses our building, uses 45% of the building time available in a week. So they are using those spaces. They need to pay portions of the debt service, the operation and maintenance, and there is no money in that particular budget to cover the administrative tasks associated with running the program. So when you add all of those things up, the profit obviously diminishes, but certainly it's a huge piece of what we do. Our services for seniors continue to expand. We're trying to do things weekly instead of just twice a month. We have combined with South Portland and Scarborough to form what we're calling the Tri-Town Newcomers Group. And each community is offering programs, and we're bringing people from all three communities together so that we can do more things. Sometimes we'll want to do something of some sort of a trip, but we can't fill the whole bus, therefore it could get canceled. So now we're joining forces with Scarborough and South Portland to do more for this population. This program is pretty much pay to play. We do have a little extra money in the budget to pay for some programs, but for the most part, when they have their dinners and programs, they pay just about what the cost is for that particular program. So it's pretty much self-sustaining. The other services that Community Services provides are rentals, and the first rental property out there is what we receive by renting the farmhouse out in front of the community center. And we do get those revenues that helps to offset some of our debt service. We do birthday party services, probably 5 to 8 birthday parties a weekend. Everything from sports time to little chefs to art parties to tea parties to games galore. We provide a party service, and very few parties are happening in Cape Elizabeth homes these days. We also have the opportunity to rent out our facility, and we assist with the rental of the school properties as well, and we do generate some revenues by doing that. Some of the services that we provide is the facility scheduling for town and school buildings, Fort Williams, Fields, etc. We obviously do the scheduling of buses, and we take care of all the administrative tasks associated with the pool and fitness center. This is just one other way of showing you what percent of each program represents in terms of the total revenues that we bring in the community services. And stop me and ask questions if you have them along the way. And we've done the same thing with the proposed expenditures. You'll see that our debt service is about 16% of the total budget. 15%, that's light blue. Administration is 16%, et cetera, et cetera. This is just another way to show you what programs you are actually subsidizing. Obviously, there's no revenue for our administration. In our administration account is partial payrolls. I think, Dan, you had a question about why some positions were calculated out as how much they were paid and some positions are not. The positions that we calculate out are the ones that are part-time positions or just pertain to that particular program. They're for my purposes more than for your purposes. I know in the summertime that we need to have a director of each camp. This is what I allocate for funds. This is how many weeks they work. This is how many staff people I can hire and average pay. This is how many junior counselors and CITs I can have. And I can do that with programs like that, same with supervisors that come in. But when we're paying the administrative staff, we have a rather unique way of doing that. For instance, part of my salary comes out of administration. Part of my salary comes out of our adult ed account because we do receive some subsidy for the administration of community services. Some of my salary comes out of the pool account because we provide them with administrative services and I am their department head. And some of my pay comes out of the central office because I am the transportation administrator. So the people in the office are paid out of different accounts pertaining to what percentage of time they spend in that area. So it's not neat and tidy for how we pay our office staff. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's why it's not easy to find it.
Right. So we do, and we calculate everything in our budget. Our benefits are all calculated. Everything we put in calculates, even the percentage of time, the benefit corresponds with the amount in that account. So it's really kind of a sophisticated system, but it gives us a real look at how we're spending our time as well. So obviously, administration is an area that there's a great deal of loss. As is senior citizens are a little bit subsidized. Our operation and maintenance costs, which have gone up over $10,000 from last year, is something we don't generate revenue for, nor do we for our debt service. Everything in white is the profit margin that we make in those particular program areas. This is just a a way of showing what our budget history is over the past 10 years. Our budget in 1996 was at about $500,000 a year, and in 2006 it's at $900,000, and as you can see, we now have debt service, which has gone up a fair amount, but the town subsidy has gone up very little. And this is just a comparison of how we fare with other communities of like population and like services. As you can see, we have the highest expenditure budget, but we also have the highest revenues. We are the only community that pays debt service, and our town subsidy is somewhere about in the middle. But if you take the debt service out of there, last year, FY 2005, we actually made a profit of $8,000. Yes?
What determines the state subsidy for your service?
Well, state subsidy in adult education, we really don't have adult education in Cape Elizabeth. Adult education is high school diploma or GED and so forth. A few years ago, general enrichment classes did receive some subsidy. They no longer are subsidizable, and but you still get some monies for offering general enrichment in terms of how to help subsidize your administrative costs. So 10, 15 years ago, our state subsidy was over $55,000, but over the years, we've all been reduced. And what we have just doesn't really, is not defined as adult ed, recreation and leisure. But it is somewhat determined by what the town subsidizes you buy in the area of adult ed. So if you don't subsidize us, then we wouldn't get any subsidy from the state. Okay, so you have to subsidize us to some extent for us to get anything back from them. It's sort of a match, it's not a match, it would be a percentage of people.
I'm not sure the percentage is.
So we get a little, and we get less every year.
It varies so much, I think.
Does. Those towns do more, and in some of those towns, adult ed is a separate department. They don't have a community services concept. Freeport does both. Gorham is separate. Cumberland is separate. Falmouth does both, and Yarmouth does both. But they do more in line with academic adult ed than we do here in Cape Elizabeth. We used to be a testing site, but you have to maintain so many people a year accessing your program to do that. So if someone needs services in Cape Elizabeth, we do have a tutor that we contract with that helps to prepare them to take the testing for them. And we may get two calls a year. So it's not, there's not a, and I think probably the stigma in Cape Elizabeth, if they needed it, they probably would rather go to Portland than come to us. So there isn't a great supply and demand here. And the bottom line is residents of Cape Elizabeth get everything community services offers for about 11 cents. The median home, valued at $251,000, pays $27.65 per year for community services. Now, if we go back, and I did, because every year I try and present a flat budget, and I tried hard to do that this year, and I just couldn't make it work, even cutting the customer service position. So I was going back through some of my records, and when the community center project was proposed, and we sent out that informational flyer on how we were going to pay for this building in 2002, and what that newsletter said was, and I had kind of forgotten this, is that the first year that we had the building, there would be no impact on the tax rate. But when the debt service was at its peak, in the second and third year, it was anticipated there would be an 8 cent increase. And so, which is far below that 1 cent that we have proposed for this budget.
Any questions?
If that's your whole report.
Two voices call.
You ready for it? Since I'm last, it's going to be short and sweet. In the district-wide budget, there has been no changes in any of the lines. The increases that you see is the increases in salaries and benefits. Any questions?
Do that again.
See, so Jeff, you have to come after.
Oh, wait till we're after.
Did you get up and say, I have nothing? Thank you very much. I guess we'll do the wrap up then. Bob, did you want to do that, or do you want to ask questions?
Just a quick section.
All right.
In looking at the budget, there are some accounts that we haven't really dealt with. They're called system-wide accounts. And there's no reason to deal with them in any way, because for the most part, they are exactly the same as last year, unless we weren't spending as much and then we cut them. Or if we had a shortfall, there is one that we, well, we'll just skip them down a little bit. On page 8 of your summary, the office of the superintendent, you left very much the same. With a new person coming in, they're going to have to figure out how they're going to run that office and what is needed. We did go through, for example, we were able to decrease liability insurance on.
Yes, we changed carriers.
We changed carriers.
Bob, that's page 8 under.
Page 8 under the summary of the budget.
With details.
Under facilities management, you see some changes. Capital improvements are down. That's because we worked on the capital improvement budget a while ago. Contract repairs were down a little bit. Heating oil, of course, is up. And facilities management down below, again, there's some lines down and up, but they're mainly caused by things like heat and light and water and all those kinds of things.
I just wanted to, a couple questions that he had. I remember when he met with us that he felt that, I think it was the oven or in the kitchen, I noticed that was cut out. Well, wasn't there something in the kitchen in the middle school? That it was like he was repairing, but he thought it could break at any time.
Right.
So we're going to take that risk that we're not going to replace it?
That's right. We pushed it over to the next CIP.
Okay, I'll trust his judgment on that. The ductwork cleaning, which is out again.
Yes.
Is that, are there health ramifications for that?
We've been mirror tested each of the last.
Oh, it's been for the last 5, 6, 7 years.
There's no problems with any of the air test surveys. So it's a matter of, there doesn't seem to be a problem.
Because I do remember when he talked about that last year, he said, you know, that he was concerned.
He's still concerned. It was one of those things that, I think it was $10,000?
Yes.
That you said, do we spend another $10,000 here if there don't seem to be problems? And I know that's what it came down to. As long as we keep monitoring, I'm not concerned. You know, if we weren't, if the checks weren't there, I would be concerned. On page 9, again, we have, you know, telephone up a little bit, electricity up, heating oil up. Under system-wide instructional support 9010, Trish had asked about this future direction plan line in 1251. This is where we take out lots of, anytime we bring in somebody, I think there was somebody brought in to help with sixth grade writing at the high school. That's where that money comes from, it's from that line. So when we break out all of the staff development, that'll be clearer. But it also takes care of things like our dues with, the reason it's up is because of the dues for Castro Bay Educational Alliance. Those dues will cost us about $8,000, if I remember. And so we're not up the full $8,000 because we're using some other monies from there to help with that. There's also some decreases. We're not sending as much out to printing, particularly with the color printers that we have in-house. For example, the brochure we used for the superintendent search, you remember we did in-house, thanks to Mary. So that's those kinds of things help. And you know, the volunteer services is in there. There are no changes. We did eliminate the Chapter 127 support that's been talked about in both the Palm Cove and the high school budget. And the health services district-wide, they had requested another nurse. We did not feel we could put that in the budget. And so their lines stay very close to the same. There was a slight increase with some equipment and other things there. That's about the end of it. And no, it's not the budget that I'd love to be sitting here saying, we're doing everything that we wanted to do, and we're covering everything that we, you know, want to cover in the futures plan and the, you know, school plans and whatever. But I don't think it's a bad budget. I think going back to that list of things that I gave you at the front, things it didn't do, it doesn't increase class sizes, it doesn't change several things that could be worse in my mind than some of the effects that this budget will have. And I'll just leave it there other than questions.
Back in that instructional support, the 9-10, I'm just curious again, what the increase in the central supply, it's like $9,000. I was just curious to know what that is.
Okay, where again?
The central supply, the actual budget FY204 was $21,000. The budget 205, so I don't know what the budget, I don't know what the actual is for this year, it's 32. I'm just curious to know why from our last actual, which was 22, the 21 is going up to 30.
Where are we?
9010, system-wide instructional support on page 9, the last line, just account 1610, that's central supply.
Okay, thank you.
That central supply is for photocopy paper for all of the schools. It comes out of this account, it doesn't come out of each individual school. The reason that we did the actual for 04 was less, because we had a surplus of paper for that year, so we didn't want to purchase paper and just have it sit there in storage. And also we've been getting some, I mean, the cost of paper has been going up, but we've been getting some pretty good prices, and they've been steady over the last.
What's our accuracy data? You probably know about it, do you know? Against the budget, what it is?
We order most of our paper in the fall, but if we do have surplus, now we like to wait.
Oh, okay, so it may be meaningless then, won't it?
We have spent $15,000 so far.
Well, I'm just saying that if do we need that, that extra difference in the classroom, classroom.
Well, we will next year. If we have a surplus of paper, we're probably running down on what we have currently.
But does that $16,000 expenditure reflect a a decrease in the surplus, or are we building it up again? Is that $16,000 actually this year's cost? I'm not asking that right. You said in 2004, it was low because we were using a surplus from previous years. Are we still using that, or is the $16,000 reflective of the true cost for this year?
We will need to order some paper for this year.
Another $16,000 is only 3 more months.
Probably not 16.
But that's why we cut it by 2,000, because we, for the coming year, because we're going from 32 down to 30.
Right, but if you're at 16 now, you'd have to spend another $16,000 to get to the current budget level. And you've only got 3 or 4 more months of school, even if you ramp up. That seems high to me, still. And I don't mean to debate small amounts, but a couple thousand dollars is a classroom of furniture that we've given up somewhere else. Do you know what I mean? If we've only spent $16,000 and we have March, April, May, half of it.
Let's look at it. And
just out of curiosity, I hate to even be debating $3,000, but.
I have a big picture question. Mm-hmm. If we go to the town with all the supporting materials and the decision ultimately is not to give us access to the
58,000 dollars.
Will you be making the recommendation that we not bring the laptop forward and we accept the budget as is? Or will you be looking at this budget to find, or having us take a look at the budget to find money to bring the laptop forward to town?
First of all, I hope that that will not happen. I think there's some good arguments to be made for being able to use that money. Mm-hmm. If it does not happen, I don't know that I can find $58,000 to take out of other things, and I'm almost sure I can't without seriously hurting other programs. Mm-hmm. It may have to be put on hold for a year, or something like that. The whole implementation of the 10th grade. We also, at that point, would probably have to look at other ways of deploying the computers, the laptops we have. Remember, we're on a 4-year lease with those. It's already been, we've already committed to that lease. But we certainly could make use of them too, in other ways than simply only ninth graders have. But I don't even want to go there because I think that's a much less acceptable plan than continuing the implementation of the 10th grade if you want. So.
We don't have a press here anymore. But that being said, that is going to be the opportunity cost for a decision not to give us the money. That's where the public.
Yep.
Let's see. That's what it is.
Yep.
So that's all I need to. I want to be very clear.
Yeah, I'm not going to come back and say no. We're going to go looking for the
50. And in theory, that's targeted. You can look at it another way. It wasn't targeted for that, but it rightfully belongs to the school department. We're also making a decision to buy laptops instead of filling one of these teacher positions.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't have that option because the money is only targeted
for
technology.
That's correct.
I just have a comment about the athletic budget, and I realize Keith isn't here, but I'm just going to get past that. I thought everything that's proposed makes sense, but there's just one thing that concerns me, and I guess I just need more information on it, and that's, every year with the football program, we've increased the funding more, the lacrosse program, to hire the coaches that we need on and stuff, which I think we should be doing. But I'm just wondering what the decision-making process has been that we've been able to do all that, but not be able to increase our athletic position to a full-time position. And given the fact that all of the surrounding communities have full-time athletic directors, I need to understand how we are able to run such a really exceptional athletic program, and maybe, I mean, there must be some answers to that, but, I mean, how's that decision being made to keep that position at a part-time level? And,
Do you know if that's come up on the athletic advisory? I don't remember discussing it at all at our meeting I was at, and it did not come up in any recommendation that came to me.
If I were to speak, I'd be speaking as a previous school board member. The discussions have come up in the past on previous school boards. I think that probably John Casey could probably speak a little bit about how athletics was looked at and where some of the shortfalls were with a part-time athletic director, and how the decision was made to put someone in at the middle school. So if you were to add that position to the three-quarter time athletic director at the high school, you're getting closer to a full-time position to meet the needs of 7th through 12th grade athletes.
That's what happened in my previous history.
It still doesn't come up to the total amount of money that we would be paying for a full-time athletic director. It was just our kind of solution to the budget crisis at that time. John, if you want to add more things, or Nancy?
Well, I do know from, again, from town as me, that you have a unique agreement with Keith's contract, and that part of the benefits, right? Part of his contract is tied into benefits and retirement. And I'm not sure financially how that works, but I know that was a big factor in that decision to keep it where it was, I'm going to say 5-6 years ago, probably. Am I right on that timing?
No.
No? Longer?
Yes.
Yeah. So what you're saying is that it's based on his particular...
It is tied particularly to Keith.
And not to the overall position of our athletic director in this community.
I believe the athletic study committee that did a report last year even had some suggestions in it for increasing that position, but due to budget constraints, we had not followed through and gone forward with that decision, because we do not have the budget to support it. But I believe even the most recent athletic study committee came up with the idea that this should be a full-time position. But at this time, our budget is not able to support that.
And when it was proposed to increase the hours, it was also at the expense of, we'll take his secretary away, and we'll take the middle school athletic director away, because then he'll do both jobs, which, if you look at it, you can pay him full-time, you still need someone in the middle school to run the middle school athletics, which is what every surrounding community does.
They have some middle school.
Absolutely.
As well as full-time athletic
directors.
Yes. So, okay, it doesn't balance out. Well, I mean, I just want to put it out there that I think that that's something that, in some way, you know, we need to address that. I mean, if that's in study after study, then I'm not familiar with what you're talking about, Nancy, but whatever study that is you're referring to.
I think if you look back, I think about that, even maybe 2 or 3 years old now, Jim Rowe was the board person on that. So maybe it's 3 years.
Because with the whole, with the sports done right,
some of this stuff can't be discussed.
Well, I'm just asking about the funding of the athletic.
No, I understand, but to answer your particular questions, that has to be session.
Okay, so then my final comment is just that given the Sports Done Right program that's, you know, emerged this year, I think that there are a lot of changes philosophically around sports, and I think maybe some of this can tie into that whole discussion.
Just for the record, prior board to have discussed the issue. And it is what it is today. That's number one. Number two is the notion, I reject entirely the notion that whether or not we have a full-time or part-time athletic director is based on any recommendation from the athletic steering committee. That's a school board decision. that we should be made. Further, I'm not sure that decisions made by the athletic steering committee bind us to anything.
But they were at that discussion.
We're going in a different direction. For example, just for the record, in terms of the football coach, I don't ever remember that being brought to the board. I believe that was a decision discussed in the athletic committee. I'm not going to challenge it, but there was a lot of tightening up that needs to be done, and unfortunately, this is not the place to do it, although it is the right place to pose the questions there.
Anybody else? No? Okay, well, thank you very much. I appreciate everybody coming. I appreciate the hard work.
Justin, you may want to mention if this is going to be televised, that the next time we're probably going to be discussing these issues, the budget, will be the evening of the 22nd of March, where we're scheduled for a workshop and then for a special meeting to vote on the budget. Because that would be our only opportunity before the March 31st deadline to turn the budget over to the town council.
And that would be at what time?
I believe that workshop is, Mary, 7 o'clock at the high school, is it? Is that workshop?
7 o'clock at the high school library?
Yes.
On the March 22nd? Okay.
As long as that's a Tuesday.
As long as it's a Tuesday that's not snowing.
That's right.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time, and especially on the Saturday.